As Jesus traveled Israel with his followers, healing and teaching, people would often ask questions about God and about how to best follow God's ways. Many times, Jesus would use stories to convey what he wanted them to understand. On one occasion, a man who was a religious expert tried to test Jesus. He said he knew that the Jewish law commanded him to love God and love his neighbor. But the man asked Jesus, "Who is my neighbor?" So Jesus told the man and those around a story. A man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho when he was attacked by robbers. They stripped him of his clothes, beat him, and went away, leaving him half dead. A Jewish priest happened to be going down the same road. And when he saw the man, he passed by on the other side. So too, a Levite, another Jewish religious leader, when he came to the place and saw him, passed by on the other side. But, Jesus continued, a Samaritan, a group of people the Jews despised, came where the man was, and when he saw him, he took pity on him. He went to him and bandaged his wounds, pouring on oil and wine. Then he put the man on his own donkey, brought him to an inn, and took care of him. The next day, he took out 2 denarii and gave them to the innkeeper. "Look after him," he said, "and when I return, I will reimburse you for any extra expense you may have." Then Jesus turned to the religious expert. "Which of these 3 do you think was a neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of robbers?" The expert replied, "The one who had mercy on him." Jesus told him, "Go and do likewise."
If the Dodgers had been in, I would have worn half blue and half, all right. But they're not, so I didn't. Anyway, aren't you glad we don't have anything competing for our attention today, all right, this morning? So we can, isn't this strange? We can focus on Jesus today. What a novel idea. Welcome today. If you're visiting New Hope, it's great to have you here. There are some visitor cards in the pew in front of you. We would love for you to get one. Fill it out. Drop it in the offering bag when it comes by. And next week, through the mail, we'll send you information that tells you about our church family. If you have, if you're part of the church family and you've got messages to the staff or prayer requests, please take that same card, write on it, drop it in the offering bag, and we'll tend to those as soon as we possibly can. Next Sunday night, special time for our church. Next Sunday night, we are having a baptism night, all right? We've got 12 to 15 to baptize, all right? And a couple of those are folks who, just since we started the Believe series, have started a personal relationship with Christ. We often do this on Sunday mornings, but because of the series we're in, we don't have time for the next 30 weeks, and we don't want to wait 30 weeks to do this. So we're having a special service this coming Sunday night, and I know often this is most touching if they're relatives of yours, but remember, because they're being baptized, they are relatives of yours, all right, in the family of God. So let's come and celebrate this kind of first birthday, all right, and let's come out and enjoy that next Sunday evening, 6 o'clock, right here as we share in baptisms. I'll make my wife mad if I don't do this. Sunday morning is Pastor Appreciation Morning. You'll recall last year, it's the most unsettling Sunday for the pastors of the church. It's so nice of you to do that, and it's in the bulletin about what we're doing next Sunday morning, but here's the deal. You want to appreciate this pastor next Sunday? Show up next Sunday night for the baptism, all right? Because that is just an awesome time for us to share together. The No More Blues Closet. This is a men's clothing closet at Prison Fellowship Office for when men are released from incarceration. They often come out with no family, no place to go, and no clothes except the clothes on their back. And they need a suit of clothes for going to apply for work. They just need the most basic of toiletries. And so if you have some gently used clothes, what that means is, don't bring your holy underwear you're ready to use for a dust rag, all right? Bring the stuff you've outgrown, okay, and probably aren't going to get back to, all right? unless you're on the Daniel plan, all right? But if you have some stuff, you know, and they'll certainly even take new, okay? But they could use some. They're very, very low in their men's department. And also toiletries for men, all right? You know, things like shaving cream and razors. And we don't want those gently used either. We want those brand new, all right? But shaving cream, toothbrushes, that kind of stuff, if you can help out, you can drop it off at the church or the PF office, and they will be happy to put that to use. Christmas choir rehearsals have started, but if you haven't made the first one yet, it is not too late. Show up this Wednesday night at 7 o'clock. They would love to have you here. Senior luncheon this Tuesday. If you're 55 or older, you are welcome to come. If it's your first time, just show up. If you've been before, you know the routine. And special guest speaking at the luncheon this week is Diana Rood, going to share some stories and pictures from their trip to Colombia on their short-term mission trip earlier this year with the Actus family. This afternoon, 1 o'clock right here in the sanctuary, children's drama rehearsal. Church golf tournament is next Saturday. Everybody should have been signed up who's going to play in that already. Save the date. Hope Fest, October the 24th, Friday night, 6 to 9, out here in our parking lot, sharing with three other churches' worship teams. Just a night of worship out in the parking lot. Weather ought to be beautiful, unless it rains, and if it does, we'll be really grateful for rain, all right? But anyway, it should be a wonderful evening. We need two more volunteers who could help assisting with our parking arrangements that night. So if you'd be willing to help out a first-time ministry get launched, just take one of the cards in the pew, write on it, Hope Fest Volunteer, put your name, phone number, and email address, and Amanda Christensen will follow up with you in just the next couple of days. But they could use two more. Everything else has been covered for that evening. Harvest Fest. Hope Fest, Harvest Fest. Hope Fest is Friday night, out in the parking lot singing. Hope Fest is Harvest Fest is our annual event that we do on Sunday preceding Halloween. And this is a day where you get fed for free, all right? There'll be freshly barbecued hamburgers and hot dogs. And tri-tip. No hamburgers this year, tri-tip this year? Oh man, we moved up. Okay, we moved up. So tri-tip, you got to write this stuff out for me, babe. I thought tri-tip was always in April. Did I get these confused? Okay. It's my age. It's showing on me. But anyway, it's free food, all right? And it's always good. It's freshly cooked. And then there's activities for the kids. So it's right after the 10:45 service, so about 12:15. And it's just a great time for our church family. So we'll hope you'll come and get that on your calendar and join us for that. A couple of prayer requests. Janice Dunnington and her family, we had Ed's memorial service here on Wednesday. We had a wonderful celebration for Ed. Thank so many of you for coming and helping out with the luncheon that was made available. But we really did have a chance to celebrate Ed's life. And Ed was married once before Janice. And it wasn't a good marriage, I found out. And what was remarkable was his ex-wife was at the service. And she came up during the luncheon, and she, with tears down her face, she said, "I just got to tell you, you have no idea how much joy came to my life when I heard that Ed had become a Christian." And she said it took several years after he became a Christian, but reconciliation took place between us. After all those years of really hatred between us, to have all of that done. And she said, and then just 2 months before he died, we had a chance encounter, because he always visited my mom. And we had a chance encounter at my mother's. And she said, we actually, for the first time in our lives, had an opportunity to pray together. And she said, "I've just thanked God all week. And to know that he could have this kind of service at his death was so different than what I knew early in his life. You have no idea how happy I am." And that was just a sweet, sweet end result of that service. But Janice was in church this morning, so pray for her and the rest of her family as they go through with this. Fernwood's sister, her 100-year-old, 9-month and 6-day sister, her memorial service was last week, but remember them. Marianne Ramirez, continue to remember Marianne as she is going through her challenges right now with stage 4 liver cancer. Ray Steele, shared with you, he's diagnosed and undergoing treatment for lung cancer. Jerry Brown, sitting right here, he's got a name badge on in case he forgets his name. But Jerry went for a checkup this week, and he ended up in the hospital, and they put another stent in. They did that Friday, and he went home Saturday. How many stents do you now have, Jerry? 7, all right? Okay. I understand they're cheaper by the dozen. You're working on it. Okay, and so we want you to be praying, but we're glad he's doing well. I've been handed a couple of notes. Pray for Mickey. Mikey, I always do that. I like the mouse. She's got some serious knee and leg issues, all right? She's had those ever since her husband knocked her down in the dining room. that's a joke from Wednesday night, I'm sorry. So do be praying for them. And then Melissa Puckett, Melissa's sitting over to my left, her dad Gene is having an angiogram done in Bakersfield on Tuesday. He had triple bypass a year ago. He's done very well, but recently he's experiencing exhaustion with exertion. And so they're concerned, and they're going to be following up with him this coming week. So please be praying for Gene. Let's see here. Janet Mattson had back surgery, very serious back surgery on Tuesday. She is now home. She's recovering. She has pain, but it's a different kind of pain and less severe than what she had before the surgery. So that is great news. And then Melvin and Ellen Dinsford in our church, Melvin's mother of 97, her age was 97. She passed away at the end of the week, and those services are being scheduled for this coming week. So those are the updates that we wanted to share with you today. If you are new to New Hope today, this is your first time, we are in the midst of a 30-week series called Believe. And we're kind of doing the triathlon study of the Bible. The first 10 weeks, we are looking at the key truths of the Bible, what we build our life on. The second 10 weeks, we are going to be looking at the key practices of the church, those things that reinforce what we believe. And then the last 10 weeks, we will be looking at the 10 key virtues that God wants to produce in us based on what we believe and what we do. And you can go to the website if you've missed the others, because when you build a foundation for a home, you want it to be solid. You want the whole foundation to be there, not just part of it. And so go to the website. If you missed a Sunday, go to the website. It's all there. If they're not posted on the front page, click on the month, all right, and the date that you missed, and it will pop up there. And today we are looking at key truth number 8. How many of you read your chapter this week? Raise your hand. Oh, that's down a little bit. How many of you promised to catch up by next week? Okay, all right, good job. All right, because it helps when you read the chapter. Some of you are saying, read what chapter? There is a special Bible that's been put together just for this study. It is called Believe. These are the scriptures organized by the subject, by the doctrine, by the practice, by the virtue. And they're available out in the, are they available today out in the pavilion? They are $10, $5, or free. Don't you like the pricing here? If money's okay, $10. If money's tight, $5. If you're broke, it's free. Just pick one up, all right? We'd love you to have it, and we'd like you to read the chapter before you come. During our offertory today, we are going to be showing you something brand new that we've never done here at New Hope. So please pay close attention. It is a ministry done by Samaritan's Purse. This is Franklin Graham's ministry. Franklin Graham, the son of Billy Graham. And this is called Operation Christmas Box. And you, Cheryl, are you in here? Cheryl? Oh, you're over here on this side. Cheryl, stand up. Hold that box right there. All right. This is a shoe box. And the video is going to tell you about the stuff that's in that shoe box. What you see there doesn't have to be the way yours looks, but you're going to find out all about it. Here's what I love about this is a small box can teach a child about the love of God. It can lead him or her to faith. What goes in that box can be fun at Christmas time. But what comes out of the box is often eternal. And you and I can be a part of changing lives through the power of a very simple gift. After you see the video during the offering, when the service is over today, you can go out to the pavilion and not only get a cup of coffee, but you can pick up a box that you can take home. It has a green instruction form in it. It will tell you how to fill the box. You can go to the dollar store and do most of this, or go to Target, and then it tells you how to ship the box. And they have given out now over 1 million boxes to children in the 1040 window, the most impoverished parts of the world. And it's just remarkable the impact this has. And so along with Angel Tree that we will do the next month, we're going to get in a head start for Christmas, and we're going to do the Christmas box. So I'm going to ask our ushers to come forward. Please turn your attention towards the video screen, and during the offering, watch what the Christmas box is all about. Let's pray. Our Father, we love you. Thank you for sharing your life with us. Thank you, Father God, that you cared about us so much that while we were still alienated from you, while we were still ignoring you, you sent your son to die for us. You sent your son to show compassion to us. You sent your son to do for us what we could never do for ourselves. Father, thank you for the difference that being forgiven makes in our life. We don't carry around the guilties. We don't have this sense of doom and condemnation. But Father, by your grace, we have been free to experience and share in life. Father, we thank you for your comfort in the lives of those who've experienced loss this week, and we thank you for the joy of those who've experienced addition this week. We thank you for a new little boy who's been born to Bethany this week. And we are so grateful. He's well and he's healthy and mom and dad are doing good. And so we give you thanks for both the joys as well as the challenges, knowing that you are our strength for everything. For the privilege of giving today, Father, we thank you that as you have been so generous with us, we have the opportunity to be generous with you. May we give freely with a joyful heart. We trust you with the needs of those who are facing tests and surgeries. And we thank you for the strength you provide for them as they're in the waiting room of life. Lord, we're grateful that Terry has found out what was wrong with his foot and they're able to deal with it. And so we say thanks for answered prayer. Lord, I trust that in the message today, all of us will hear your voice as you speak in our hearts. We commit this to you in the awesome name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Operation Christmas Child is one of the great stories that's unfolding in our lifetime.
Every single box is important because it connects to hearts. The heart of the person who packs the box and the heart who is in need of that love.
I think it's an awesome opportunity to change the world.
We have led the children from the box to the Bible.
Thank you.
This is just so awesome to give these children the opportunity to experience the love of Christ in a way that they've never experienced before in their lives.
We are only seeing just the beginning of this project because the Lord, He's got something that is beyond our imagination into the millions and into the billions. And these children will change the world.
Doesn't that fill your heart with compassion? Don't you want to get engaged and do something? Yeah. So after the service today, worship team, come on up. Go out into the pavilion, the box is there. Remember, Jesus said, don't stop the little children from coming to me. And maybe we need to change that just a bit, and that we don't need to stop going to the little children. Do you realize they are the leaders of the next generation? If we can get Christ in them and get corruption out of them at an early age before it takes root, what a difference they will make in their own world. And you and I have an opportunity to do that. Let's stand and sing together. That is those of you who are under 45 probably are saying, huh? Where did you find that tape? All right. But I dare say, okay, I'm looking for, all right. Have you heard that song before? See, she's a teenager. All right, 8, 19, 18? 21, are you 21 already? When did that happen? Holy mackerel. Guy, you're old, mother. Man, okay, 21. They still have heard that song. It's been around. But it was made popular in 1965. The words were written by Hal David and the music composed by, Burt Bacharach. All right. It was first recorded by the young lady you saw right there. How many of you remember her name? Jackie DeShannon. She was the first one to record it. We had some folks who thought Dionne Warwick was the first one to record it. She was not. She turned it down. She did record it later, all right? But she was not the first one to record it. Bacharach, as the way the history goes, initially did not believe this song could make it, and he was reluctant to play it for DeShannon. He thought it was too simple, and it wouldn't catch on. However, it has now been recorded and performed live by over 100 artists over 40 years of time. It's been used in at least 8 movie soundtracks, most notably Bob and Carol, Ted and Alice, My Best Friend's Wedding, and Forrest Gump. You see, guys, simplicity is often very, very powerful. And that's what has impressed me with this Sunday's key truth: compassion. I have had the opportunity for the last 2 weeks to prepare today, and I've been exhaustively looking through the scriptures at what it says and what it means by this word compassion. And I think the best and simplest definition for the term is love with an attitude. An attitude that is willing to suffer with others. I believe this is the quality of love that our world desperately does need now. Today, you and I are going to explore the world's greatest needs, God's greatest resources, and discover how God wants to work through you and through me to supply His resources to a needy and a very desperate world. It's time, folks. It's time that you and I make a difference. You see, if we say that I believe God is God, and that God is personal, and the way to have a relationship with this eternal and personal God is through salvation, as the Bible tells us it is, and if I believe that the Bible is the Word of God as it declares itself to be, and as the historical evidence testifies that it is, then I can know that my identity does not have to be based on my sinful humanity, but now, because of salvation, you and I have been identified as a child of God. We are now a member of His family called the church. And if all of that is true, and that's the first 7 truths we've been studying, then the attitude of my heart and your heart should reflect the attitude of our Father's heart. And His heart is filled to overflowing with compassion. And so the question in front of us today is mine. Does my heart overflow with compassion for the needs and the sufferings of others? On page 124 in your Believe Bible, or found in the book of Psalm, chapter 82, verses 3 and 4, we have these words that the psalmist wrote. He said, "Defend the weak and the fatherless. Uphold the cause of the poor and the oppressed. Rescue the weak and the needy, and deliver them from the hand of the wicked." Cain, the brother of Abel, asked a rather powerful question back in Genesis chapter 4. His really was a question of self-justification. It's a question that has been used and misused countless times. When Cain asked the question, "Am I my brother's keeper?" Are we? You see, Jesus' teachings, as well as His actions throughout His life, answers that question, I believe, with a clear and resounding absolutely yes. We are. If we are going to reflect the image of our Father, then we have to say yes to the question, "Am I my brother's keeper?" We are our brother's and our sister's keeper. In fact, a spirit of caring for others permeates the entire New Testament like no other period of time, and it should permeate the heart and the actions of every believer today. This word compassion, as it is put together in the Bible between the Old and New Testament, is a term that means to be moved inwardly. This starts from the inside and ends up with expression on the outside. We are to have a yearning motivated by tender mercy. We are to have affection and empathy. This refers to the deepest possible feelings that you and I could ever experience. You have heard the phrase, moved with compassion? Have you ever eaten some food that moved through you with some passion? Okay? I know that's a little graphic, all right? But I hope you get the point. You see, for you and I to let the passion of God flow through us, it is going to create at times almost that kind of nausea to us because we are unaccustomed. When you eat a food that you are unaccustomed to eating, it has that impact on you. And when you feel the kind of emotions that God wants us to feel, it will be new to us. And we are moved with compassion. The term literally comes to describe our inner organs. We get another expression today, from the bottom of my heart. Someone has defined compassion as sympathy coupled with a desire to help. Sympathy means the capacity to share feelings, to enter into the same feelings, to feel the same thing. But compassion takes us beyond that. It's sharing the feelings and then possessing the desire to help them at their point of trouble. Compassion. The entry point to compassion is a willingness on your part and mine to come alongside somebody else whose needs are greater than yours. We don't necessarily have to fix it, but we are willing to walk the trenches with them. A brief study through the Gospels will reveal to us the truth that Christ's compassion had no boundaries. Jesus felt the need of all classes and all kinds of people. His love and His compassion are a challenge to you and me today in how we'll respond to the circumstances we find ourselves in. Let me highlight just five quick things about the ministry of Jesus Christ. In fact, I want to read two specific verses, and I've got to go to this Bible. But in Matthew chapter 9, verse 36, Matthew chapter 9, verse 36, Jesus says this. Jesus went through all the towns and villages, teaching in their synagogues. When He saw the crowds, He had compassion on them because they were harassed and helpless. They were like sheep without a shepherd. These were men and women who were just scattered by the events of life. And Jesus said, "My heart is moved with compassion." In the same book, but chapter 15, verse 32, Jesus once again says this. The people were amazed when they saw the dumb speaking and the crippled made well and the lame walking, the blind seeing, and they praised the God of Israel. And Jesus called His disciples to Him and said, "I have compassion for these people. They have been with Me for 3 days and they have had nothing to eat. I do not want to send them away hungry or they may collapse on their way home. I have compassion for these who have been scattered in life." In Mark's Gospel, chapter 5 and chapter 16, we discover that Jesus also had compassion for those actively engaged in sin. In these two particular passages, we find where one of them was involved in demonic activity, intentionally pursuing demonic worship, and the other one, it's Peter, who had betrayed Christ 3 times before the rooster crowed the following morning. And we see Jesus going to both of those, actively engaged in their sin, and he was moved by compassion to restore them to a healthy relationship with Him. We find in Matthew's Gospel chapter 14 and Mark's Gospel chapter 1 where Jesus feels compassion for those who are sick and crippled. We see in Luke chapter 17 where Christ demonstrates compassion for those who are suffering, those who've experienced the death of a loved one, and Jesus is moved to do something about it. And then we find in Mark chapter 10 where Christ expresses compassion for those who are seeking Him, those who are looking for a change in life, for a different way to live than what they've always known. Why was Jesus able to do this to so many different kinds of people in so many different settings and circumstances? I will suggest to you it's because Jesus, even though He knew all of their faults, did not let their problems get in the way of His compassion and His expression of love. He did not look just at what was apparent on the surface. He was able to look at those people, see their deepest need, and He loved them at the deepest level of His being. And as a result, He was never impatient with them. Oh, how I wished I could get to that place in my relationship with Him that I did not grow impatient with the needs of others. And He was never offended by the types of need that they had. So here's a question. How do you see people? When you see the beggar on the street corner and you notice
He's got better tennis shoes than you would ever pay for. How do you look? How do you see them? We often base our evaluation of a person by what we see with our eyes and what we hear with our ears. We have different ministries we're engaged with around here. It's possible that you and I hear about folks who were in prison, like where Joe, John, and I went last week to Angola Prison, and you might think they're getting what they deserve. And you're right. That's justice. But folks, justice should always be tempered with mercy. And just because they're getting maybe what they deserve, it doesn't mean what they ought to always have. The warden of Angola Prison did not set out in life to become a warden. He was an agricultural teacher. His first job was at a minimum security prison teaching agriculture. The warden died unexpectedly and he was appointed interim warden. He did so well there, they appointed him warden of a bigger prison. And then when all the corruption in Angola was exposed and they had to bring a new warden in, they brought this guy who had a very clean record in. Warden Kane's mother, when he got his first job as a warden, called her son to her home. She says, God has put you there, and it is your duty and your responsibility to make sure every man in the prison that you're responsible for has a chance to have eternal life. Their life here may not be good, but they do not have to spend eternity in a bad life, and it's your job. That was a man who listened to his mama, and he took the most corrupt and most dangerous prison in America, and he has transformed it into an exemplary prison, a place where others come to model what they're doing there. And the reason we went, twofold, they had a rodeo. I wanted to go to the rodeo. Someday I'll show you what convict poker looks like at a rodeo ground, all right? But you see, it's the rodeo that funds all of the faith-based ministries that have transformed and changed that prison. I had a conversation with an inmate there. He's about 6'3", 6'4", black, from Louisiana. His name is Lee. I told Lee I would tell our church family about him because I want us to pray for him. 2 weeks from last Friday, Lee will be meeting Carol. I found that quite interesting because Lee and Carol just live two houses down from the church in the big yellow house. Copeland, they're the ones who donated the property for New Hope. All right, so I'll never forget this couple's name, Lee and Carol. Lee will never get out of prison, but he is one of the most trusted of the trustees there. He lives actually in a zone that's called the Free Zone, and these 18,000 acres. Lee's one who gets to go out on Sundays as part of a worship team and share his story and lead churches in praise. As long as they can get back to prison before midnight, they can take invitations to churches. In one of the churches that he's been to on several occasions, the pastor said, "You'd be perfect for my sister." And so they started writing. They've had 2 years of writing to each other. She's coming to visit him to see them face to face for the first time 2 weeks from last Friday. He's terrified. But he loves Jesus. He said, "My mama told me everything that was right when I was a kid growing up, but I thought she was stupid." He said, "Now I believe her to be the smartest woman I've ever known. I should have listened to mama." You see, God reaches into the heart of any man, any woman, any boy, any girl, in spite of their circumstances. But too often we look at outward circumstances. We look at the fact that they're in prison or on the street, that they're in a different country or they're a different complexion than we are. And what we need to learn is to look past a person's exterior and see them as God sees them. We must see their needs before we can express compassion to them. May we learn to see them as Jesus does. Stephen Covey tells of an experience he had in a New York City subway. While people were sitting quietly in a car, a man entered with a noisy and rambunctious group of children. The man sat down and closed his eyes and buried his head in his hands as though he was oblivious to his rowdy kids. The once quiet subway car was now a disturbing place of chaos. The children's inappropriate behavior was obvious to everyone except for their father. Finally, Covey confronted the man about his children. And the man opened his eyes and he evaluated the situation as if he had been unaware of everything that had transpired. "Oh, you're right, sir, and I'm sorry. I guess I should do something about them. But you see, we just left the hospital. Their mother died less than an hour ago. And I don't know what to think or do. And I guess they don't know how to handle this either." You see, compassion starts when we begin to understand the hurts of others. What do you see? A banker had just turned a man down for a loan, and then he made him an unusual offer. He said to the man, "I have one good eye and I have one glass eye. If you can tell me which one is which, I'll approve your loan." The man looked at him for a moment and then he said, "Your left eye is the good eye." The banker was surprised because he had a really good fake eye. And he said, "That's right. How could you tell?" The man said, "I detected a hint of compassion in the other eye." Yeah, that one takes a moment, doesn't it? Yeah. Does the world around you detect a hint of compassion? If not, maybe we need another eye. Luke chapter 10. It's found on page 136 and 137 in your Believe Bible. But in Luke chapter 10, Jesus tells a parable, and it's here that I want to focus our attention for a few minutes. It's the story of the Good Samaritan, and it's here that we can discover, maybe we can identify ourselves in one of the characters of the story. That's the intent of Jesus as he tells the story. He wants folks to see where they are in the story. And so what I'm going to ask you is, I don't want you to evaluate me and tell me at the end of the sermon, "Tim, I think you're this guy in that story." And I don't want you spouses to think about where your spouse is in this story. This is about you asking God to reveal to you where you are in this story. And there's four different characters. There's four different possibilities. Let's read it. On one occasion, an expert in the law stood up to test Jesus. "I'm going to make a suggestion. I have no proof of this, but I'm going to make a suggestion. I think this guy had done this before. I think this guy was present in the story that's revealed to us in Mark chapter 12. When somebody was trying to trick Jesus, and they asked him what was the greatest of the commandments, which one was most important. And Jesus kind of threw him a curve and said, there's two you can hang your hat on. Love the Lord your God with all that you are, and love your neighbor as you love yourself." So I think this guy was there then. And you'll understand why I think that as we read the rest of this. "Teacher," he asked, "what must I do to inherit eternal life?" And Jesus said, "What is written in the law? How do you read it?" And the man answered, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength, and love your neighbor as yourself." I promise you, this Pharisee wasn't smart enough to come up with that on his own. He valued all the laws. So I think he had to have been there. And he gives the right answer, and Jesus affirms that. He said, "You've answered correctly. Do this, and you will live." But the man wanted to justify himself. Why? Because obviously he hadn't done it. So he wants to justify himself, and he says, "And just who is my neighbor? It sounds a little bit like Cain. Am I my brother's keeper?" So Jesus tells him a story. One Jesus makes up on the spot, all right? He's a good storyteller. He said, "There was a man going down from Jerusalem to Jericho, and when he fell into the hands of robbers, they stripped him of his clothes, they beat him, and they went away, leaving him half dead. A priest happened to be going down the same road, and when he saw the man, he passed by on the other side. So too, a Levite, when he came to the place and saw him, he passed by on the other side. But a Samaritan, as he traveled, came where the man was, and when he saw him, he took pity or compassion on him. He went to him and bandaged his wounds, pouring on oil and wine. And then he put the man on his own donkey. He took him to an inn, and he took care of him. And the next day he took out 2 silver coins and he gave them to the innkeeper. "Look after him," he said, "and when I return, I will reimburse you for any extra expense you may have." Which of these three do you think was a neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of robbers? The expert in the law replied, "The one who had mercy on him." Jesus told him, "Go and do likewise." You see, this idea of loving our neighbors is apparently a big deal to Jesus. Since in the story, the command to serve others ranks right next to the instruction of loving God. And I think Jesus at this moment had some fun with this story. He found delight sometimes in gigging the religious hypocrites and Pharisees of his day, who had been missing the point of all of God's truth. And the hero of the story was an unsuspecting hero for the audience Jesus was talking to. The Jews would have never, in writing their own stories, they never would have made a Samaritan a hero. A Samaritan to a Jew was the scum of the earth. You see, a Samaritan man, he came from questionable birth. His parents were not of the same nationality. Early in the culture of America, a slur term for somebody who was part Indian was they were a half-breed. I'm one. Registered with the Choctaws. Haven't scalped anybody recently. But you see, a Samaritan, questionable birth. He didn't live in the right neighborhood. Not only was his birth questionable, but his spiritual credentials were suspect. He never attended Sabbath services. And as a result of questionable birth and spiritual credentials being suspect, his moral character was considered absent. Yet notice the not so subtle implications that Jesus makes as he tells this story. I believe he tells this story with the hope of unmasking hypocrisy. I believe he tells this story with the intent of exposing to this man his own selfishness. But remember, Jesus is filled with compassion. So the intent was not just to unmask and just to expose. The intent of a compassionate Savior like Jesus was to bring this man and his listeners to a place of humble repentance. And I would suggest to you today that if there's a possibility, there could be a couple of us in this room whose hypocrisy needs to be unmasked and whose selfishness needs to be exposed so that we could come to a place of humble repentance and let God reshape our heart so that we are filled and moved with compassion. Let's look at the characters in this story. The first character is a man who went down from Jerusalem to Jericho. We have no idea about this man. He was just on a trip. He doesn't tell us if he's a Samaritan or a Jew. He just a man. Could be any one of us on a trip. Robbers accosted him, stripped him, and left him to die. Here is a man in great need and in great suffering. The next character is a priest. And I love the terminology here. A priest happened by on the same road. Now, if you were a priest, you know the doctrines of the Old Testament. You know what it is to believe in a sovereign God. A priest would never believe he just happened by. A priest would have known this was a divine appointment. And what did he do? He saw the man and he crossed the street and he went on the other side. His vision was good, but his heart was hard. No compassion. The third character, a Levite, came by the same place. A Levite. What's a Levite? Out of the 12 tribes of Israel, one of them were the Levites. They did not get any land, all right? The other tribes did. The other 11 tribes were to provide for the tribe of Levi because it was out of the tribe of Levi that the priests would be called. And those who were not called to be priests were all wannabe priests. And they often were assigned other duties assisting those who were priests. They were in charge of taking care of the temple and the tabernacle worship. The Levites would have known as much about the Old Testament as the priests would have. They were also teachers of the Old Testament. So a Levite comes by. And the scripture says the Levite what? Saw him. He learned well from his mentor, because he passed by on the other side. The Levite was afflicted with the same disease as the priest. They had eyes to see, but no heart to care. They both went out of their way not to be put out. Have you ever done that? Have you ever gone around the block so you wouldn't have to see something? Have you ever gone out of the way so you wouldn't have to help? You saw somebody carrying a big box, oh, I really should help them. Oh, I've got to go this way. We go out of our way so we won't be put out. Then comes the Samaritan. He's traveling. He saw, and he had pity and compassion. And notice what the Bible says he did. He went, he treated, he transported, he provided care, he gave, and he followed up till the man was well. Verse 36 then ends with this. Which of these three do you think was a neighbor to the hurting person? Which of the three would you be? Which one best describes you? Priest, Levite, Samaritan. There's some lessons to be learned and applied from this parable. Number one, people all around us are half dead or down and out. All kinds of thieves have bushwhacked our fellow citizens. Number two, you and I can choose to pass by on the other side of the road. Two out of the three in this story did. We'd be in the majority. But I don't believe this majority rules. One out of three did the right thing. You and I have no excuse in 21st century America not to be helpful. When truth moves from our head to our heart, it becomes compassion. You and I have got to dismount and go help. Number three, we must be empathetic. Not just empathetic, we must be helpful. Number four, Jesus expanded the idea of neighbor from the people next door or down the street to a broader category. Our neighbor is a person in need. Anybody in need is our neighbor. Number five, the helper in the story knew when he needed to partner with others for a full recovery. He tag-teamed with the innkeeper to ensure the man could get what he needed. We have evidence of doing that around here from time to time. We tag-team with prison fellowship to go help those who were incarcerated. We tag team with Prison Fellowship to help children at Christmas time called Angel Tree. This year we get to tag team with Samaritan's Purse to help children in other parts of the world. We tag team some with Nancy Hines Hospice. Some of you volunteer to help out. Do you realize there are men and women every year who die in the city limits of Fresno and Clovis alone? And there are volunteers who will go and sit with men and women who have nobody else to sit with them so they don't have to die alone. My first year, 20-some-odd years ago, that I volunteered with Hines Hospice, I remember Nancy telling me the story about getting a call from the police department. They'd had a call from a neighbor that they hadn't seen this man come or go for days, and when they got there, he was on his deathbed, alone. He barely spoke English. He had no relatives, had no means of communication, literally alone, no insurance. Nancy told law enforcement, we'll take him to our house. She took him to her home. The doctor who had seen him and Nancy contacted, he said he won't live 4 to 5 days. He got into Nancy's home. He had 3 square meals a day. He had people who were coming to visit him to talk with him. He could go talk to other people. He lived over 9 months. And he was healthier the day he died than the first day they took him into his home. Why? Because somebody had compassion for him. And he thrived in that environment of compassion. Wow. The helper in the story knew he needed a partner. And sometimes we have to partner. Reggie McNeil's a writer and a former pastor. And he wrote a book. And he said, the moral to this parable is this. We've got to get off our donkey to help somebody. It's what the Samaritan did. It's what we need to do. It's time for us to get up off of whatever it is that we're sitting on and help somebody. This is a call to action today. Maybe we can't change the world, but we can change our street. We may not be able to change the overall graduation rate, but you as seniors can mentor one kid that might keep him out of dropping out from high school. We probably cannot wipe out hunger and poverty. That's a daunting task. But packing a lunch for a hungry person on a weekend is a place for us to start. And if enough of us get off our donkeys, determined to be part of a solution to address other problems, we can address this downhill slide of many people. I'm not just inviting you to a life of service. I maintain that you will get a life because of service. So here's the key question for the day. What's my responsibility to other people? If anybody were to respond to the first two beliefs of this series, God and a personal God, with the answer, I do not believe there is a God and I do not believe there is a God who is personal, then hedonism will be the philosophy that governs their life. What is hedonism? It's what Paul talked about in 1 Corinthians 15 when he said, you can eat, drink, and be merry because tomorrow you die and that's it. You'll be food for worms. Then do whatever you want. Why waste precious time trying to meet the needs of others if this is all there is? In that belief system, self-focus not only makes sense, but it's very logical. But as followers and believers in Christ, what if we adopt the opposite end of the spectrum as our driving force, becoming like Christ for the sake of others? What if love for people went from a beautiful chorus that we chant in church to a mission statement that we live out in our life? James 2, 15 and 16 says it this way. Suppose a brother or a sister is without clothes and daily food. If one of you says to them, go in peace, keep warm, be well fed, but does nothing about their physical needs, what good are you? Colossians 3, 12 says, as God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourselves. See, you and I have an intentional choice to make to move the truth from our head to our heart. It says, clothe yourself with compassion. And I believe this is a requirement before the virtues that we will get to in about 15 weeks of kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience can be seen in us. 1 Peter 3:8. All of you, who's left out? Nobody. All of you be like-minded. Be sympathetic. Love one another. Be compassionate. And be humble. To whom are we to be compassionate, kind, humble, gentle, patient, sympathetic, and loving? Everyone on the planet, according to this parable, is our neighbor. All right, so that was the key question. Who's my neighbor? Key idea? I believe God calls all of us as Christians to show compassion to people in need. Jesus makes this clear that we are to follow Him down this path of compassion. When Jesus said in Mark 10:45, even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but He came to serve and give His life a ransom for many. Jesus says in John 15:13, greater love has no man than this, that one lay down his life for his friends. You are my friends if you do what I command, Jesus said. I no longer call you servants because a servant doesn't know my master's business. Instead, I've called you friends. For everything that I learned from my Father, I've made known to you. You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you that you might go and bear fruit, fruit that will last. And so whatever you may ask in our Father's name, He is able to provide it. You see, Jesus has brought you and me into the family business, placing others first to meet needs today while also changing the future of anyone who can respond to the message of salvation. Those who are His family, that should be you and me, we should be willing to serve as Christ did. In God's kingdom, even helping a person with a temporary necessity has an eternal purpose. In Matthew 25:34, Jesus teaches His followers the divine priority of serving people. We see clearly the degree to which Jesus pays attention to the details of our lives, and he calls us to pay attention to the details of serving others. Listen to what Jesus said. Then the king will say to those on his right, you guys just happen to be on my right, come, you who are blessed, take your inheritance. The kingdom's been prepared for you since the creation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me drink. I was a stranger, and you invited me into your home. I needed clothes, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you cared for me. I was in prison, and you came to visit me. And then the righteous will answer him, Lord, I don't remember seeing you hungry or thirsty or naked or a stranger. When did we do this for you? And the king will reply, whatever you did for one of the least of these, you did it for me. The least. You see, Jesus made our mission abundantly clear. We are to meet the needs of the forgotten and the unlovely and the unpopular and the most difficult. These are the least in our view. His declaration then is to serve them and to serve him. This is both countercultural and life-changing. It may go against our human nature to be compassionate, but if you are now a child of God, it is not against the new nature that we have. When we are saved, we are given all the resources of God Himself to feel the needs and the burdens of others and to go forth and to meet those. Let's wrap this up with a key application. What difference does all this compassion make in the way I live today, in the way I think today? If we choose to show compassion to people as God does, then one, we will change our priorities and how we use our time. I would challenge you, go home, look at your day timer. I know I'm meddling. Get your pocketbook out. How is it you use the resources that God has given you? How much of it is used for self and how much of it is used for others? It's a good evaluation. Number two, you and I will be set free to give graciously because we trust God to meet our needs. I watched this exemplified in my dad's life again and again and again. In the 60s and the 70s, we weren't poor, but folks, we didn't have a whole lot either. My dad never thought we didn't have enough. And my dad always had an eye for the person who was down and out. I can't tell you the guys that he found on the street, and the guys that knocked on the door, and the folks who showed up at church. And if he saw they had a need, Dad went out of his way to meet those needs. He gave out of his abundant poverty to those who had less. And God never let him down. His family never went hungry. We always had clothes on our back. We never knew that we were not wealthy. But it takes a heart that beats with the heartbeat of God to be compassionate like that. Number three, people who have been forgotten by society will be cared for and restored to society. Number four, we will truly reach our neighborhoods and our communities, and the Spirit of Christ will be alive and well in us. The oft-quoted phrase, people don't care how much you know until they know how much you care, that will come to life. As people see how much we care and ask us what we know, we can respond with, it's not what we know, but it's who we know, and His name is Jesus. And He would love to meet you. Briefly got to the fair Thursday evening. Just long enough to have a cinnamon roll and a beer rock and gelato. And there was something else. A corn dog. Yeah. But only had half because Shelly ate the other half. but just long enough. No, I passed on the tacos. But I was wearing my Ask Me What I Believe shirt. And right at the gate, man, the guy wanted me, all right? Well, you believe? I said, I believe that Jesus Christ is my Savior, and when I die, I'm going to heaven, and between now and then, He lives in my heart. He said, give me five, man, right on, me too. All right. I was asked six times what that meant. And that was exciting. The bummer for me was, All six of them were believers. They all wanted high fives, all right? That was cool. And then Shelly said, do you realize how many people stare at your chest as we go walking by? And I wanted somebody to tell me that, Jesus who? Whoa, but it didn't happen. I guess it wasn't time. But you see, you and I get the privilege of telling folks not what we know, but who we know. In 1952, evangelist Everett Swanson went to South Korea to preach the gospel to troops in the Republic of Korea. During his visit, he was deeply moved by the number of children orphaned by the war. He discussed this issue with a missionary who challenged Swanson, "You have seen the tremendous need and the unparalleled opportunities of this land. What do you intend to do about it?" In effect, this missionary was saying, are you going to just feel sympathy for these children or are you going to express compassion? Swanson returned to the United States along with his wife Miriam, and with the help of Dr. Gus and Helen Hermall, a ministry was launched on behalf of these orphans. At his revival meetings all across the United States, Swanson began to share about the needs of Korean children. Christians began to donate funds to help meet their daily living needs. By 1954, the sponsorship program still offered today was born, whereby people could give a monthly gift to help provide shelter, medical care, and biblical instruction for a specific child. In 1963, Swanson was becoming uneasy about his name being the focus of this growing ministry. He was inspired by the words of Jesus in Matthew 15:32, I have compassion for these people. I do not want to send them away hungry. So the ministry name was changed, and it's now known worldwide as Compassion International. Go check it out. What began as a missionary's challenge to an evangelist who saw a need is today a vital ministry that serves more than 1 million children in more than 25 nations. While compassion is a deeply emotive feeling any human may experience, the Christian belief of compassion is coupled with the motivation to act on those feelings. The divine filter of seeing people as God sees them will lead us both to see the need and to find the resources to meet those needs. So may I offer to you a simple assignment before you leave this morning? The next time, and it won't be long, the next time you feel compassion starting to move in your soul, let it trigger you into action with your hands and with your feet to be Jesus to the least of these. What the world needs now is love. Sweet love, it's the only thing that there's just too little of. What the world needs now is love, sweet love, not just for some, but for everyone. Are you willing to be part of the everyone? God wants you to show Him to others. Our Father, sometimes I marvel how something people do just for fun, you can use for something so important. A 60s song reveals the heart of God. What this world needs is the compassion of God seen in the children of God to the rest of the world who is our neighbor. I pray, God, there are men and women in this sanctuary today who is asking you to reveal to them, who have I been in the story of the Good Samaritan? And I pray that every one of us will ask you to transform us into the Good Samaritan. Thank you. In Jesus' name, amen.